Just keep me covered. Too late! What? There he is! Where?
There!
What, behind the rabbit?
It is the rabbit.
You silly sod!
What?
You got us all worked up!
Well, that's no ordinary rabbit. Oh. That's the most foul, cruel and bad-tempered rodent you ever set eyes on.
You tit! I saw my arm and I was so scared.
Look, that rabbit's got a vicious streak a mile wide. It's a killer.
Get stuck.
He'll do you a treat, mate.
Oh, yeah? You manky Scots git.
I'm warning you.
What's he do? Nibble your bum?
He's got huge, sharp... he can leap about... Look at the bones!
Go on, boss. Chop his head off.
Right, silly little bidder. One rabbit stew coming right up.
Look!
Strikecraft. In a nutshell, they can be described as both a cheap and cost-efficient defensive tool. The relevant tech can be obtained very early, but cannot be used offensively until cruiser technology. It will proceed to shed any PD-less covered fleet and serve as formidable weapon for station. Obviously there is more to it, otherwise this video would have never been launched. And speaking of launched, it's been 7 months I've been working on this video and it just couldn't go out. But anyway. Let's give a little ship designer lesson for those that struggle out there. Current meta belongs to the L. Essentially you want as many L weapons or large slot weapons as possible in your fleet, and you want them to be the best. The absolute masters of this meta are both proton and neutron launchers, thanks to the absurd alpha damage they deal. And there is another key component of this meta, the very reason why people spam L weapon, something that eludes many players, is the disengagement chance. It is the very reason why people struggle while spamming corvettes in their war, and why destroyer, but most importantly cruisers, are underrated. It allows ships to live to fight another day and drastically reduce the cost in alloy of a war. The way disengagement chance work is, if your hull is below 50% of its HP, depending on the strength of the weapon, your ship may virtually stealth and become invulnerable until the fight is over. Smaller weapons have a lower chance to trigger disengagement, but it takes more shots to kill a ship, which evens it out. Air weapons have a higher chance to trigger disengagement, but oftentimes they deal way too much damage in low amount of shots, sometimes one is enough for disengagement to reliably trigger. This is especially true with the launcher line. Disengagement is a key mechanic of early mid-game fights in Stellaris, regardless of your level, but the insidious thing about launcher is that they cancel entirely these mechanics, turning fights into highly lethal and often determining battles that will affect the entire war. The same goes for X-weapon and kinetic batteries, but the former kick in much later, and the latter belongs to an overcrowded tech tree, and has a lower damage window in exchange for faster reload, which trigger more disengagement. So in all that, where does Strikecraft belong? Hangars involve swarming amount of small damage from each vessel, thus ships have very easy time retreating from them. This is still the case, even after the Strikecraft buff, with disastrous consequences in straight-up fights. The DPS boost and accuracy have greatly enhanced Strikecraft capabilities though, on top of adding utility by allowing Strikecraft to shut down missiles. My testings showed that even in straight-up fights, Hangars are still underwhelming in comparison to the L meta, even while discarding PD entirely. Sure, you won the fight, but all your remaining ships are very low on hull and you have no ability to pressure the 22 out of 24 destroyers, so we will come back for you. There is a way to turn the tide though, and it relies on the ships being trigger-happy maniacs. With a handful of corvettes in front of your cruisers, the outcome of a battle against L-heavy fleets can drastically change, and with that L-heavy fleet you can hopefully push deeper into enemy space or outright kill them. Now to the interesting part. Many have noticed Hangar fleet power, especially on Starbase, seems disproportionately inflated. There is also a little huge detail that piqued my attention. Much like in StarCraft 2, carriers have stored StarCraft, in addition of being able to produce them in battle. At some point in the game development, they decided to give carriers a technology that allowed them to unleash all their StarCraft at once, and this was eventually removed because it turned fights into often one-sided victories. It gave me the idea to try and do the same in Stellaris. What if we had all the Hangars unleashed before the fight? And it turns out, unlike StarCraft 2, Stellaris carriers have no limit to the amount of strike traffic can generate. And although you may not unleash all your StarCraft in a battle, you may release them preemptively by attacking a mining station, for instance. This method has a massive consequence on space battles. Another interesting feature of current StarCraft is their ability to confuse ships. It usually happens when there is two or more fleets in the battle. It is very hard to manipulate, and it already happened to me once in an MP by another player in that video. But the contrary stays true, the best example being how utterly dangerous it is to engage marauder systems without an overwhelming amount of StarCraft, as this changes target between enemy stations very easily. Still, as you can see, StarCraft can have devastating effect against AIs, for instance. For the next test, I decided to go bigger and use my favorite battleship build, one that used iron thrusters to squeeze an extra shield. This is a new Hangar battleship's design I came up with. Since Hangar take less power, they can feed more shield, which is quite efficient versus neutral. I also traded an extra battleship for a set of naked corvettes to soak the AFI like I did earlier in the video, and thought it'd be redundant to do the same for the neutral fleet, as StarCraft would just destroy them. Now I know those testings aren't ideal, as there are a lot of factors to take into account and some mistakes I made, and back then I didn't know about the command that allows your fleet to dunk each other's. We'll come back to that at the end of the video. What is important here is StarCraft are not only cheaper in power, but also in alloy, which technically means you can get away with more battleships than your opponent, provided you have the nav capacity or economy to supply them. I wanted to see if you wanted to go cheaper, and infamous crystal plating technologies came to my mind. Now, why talk about those platings when everyone did it before me? Well, the main drawback is supposed to be the loss of DPS when the ships get damaged, as hull integrity is directly tied with the ship fire rate. But when launched, are StarCraft affected by the hull of a mothership? That wouldn't make sense, so I made some testings about it. Two cruisers with the same amount of HP, 2.8k, but not the same hull integrity. And the results were surprising. They are in fact not affected. In the first test, I just made them fight each other and see who would come on top, but that wasn't clear enough. So I decided to make them fight a station instead and compare the time they take to kill the station. So the usage of crystal plating on Hangar fleet is actually more cost efficient than on any other fleet. I wouldn't stop there though, something was confusing me even more, the state of PD post StarCraft buff. I wanted to make a 50% destroyer fleet fight the previous cruiser fleet I had. I instead used 100% by mistake, and even though they used tier 1 flak and get tier 2 StarCraft, they got utterly stomped, so I doubt that any superior flak would have changed anything. The fight was mostly carried by the maneuver I did against the AI. The one where I pre-shot my Hangars. A good player that knows about it could prevent this by camping the upper lane or dismantling his station, so this is primarily a PvE tool, keep this in mind, even though it's by far one of the strongest. For the last fight, involving Juggernauts, with the range buff of course, the results were slightly biased. For one, fleet wasn't using no retreat, and the set of cover that I used to soak alphas was slightly too big. Even though that isn't that much relevant, but still, it's not, yeah. If the neutron fleet used one extra ammo or one extra crystal in order to use better thruster, the StarCraft fleet would probably have a much harder time to win, if it was even possible at all. I'll need to make more testings about that. So yeah, as I mentioned earlier, those testings aren't ideal. as there are a lot of factors I didn't take into account. So I'll probably make a part 2 of this video where I'll essentially answer all the questions in the comment and add some more testings. So yeah, thanks for watching.
Here's Johnny!